Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting. It's very good to be participating in an in-person event after this long time of online meetings. So I'm going to talk about how anyone can search the past web with archive.pt. Okay, so basically anyone can go here at this address and try it after my presentation. So who are we? We are a free online service to research the past web, and we preserve publicly accessible information related to Portugal, but also to research and education content. So in this case, we preserve international content. We are a governmental service provided by the Foundation for Science and Technology, and we are a digital research infrastructure. So the project began in 2007. I've been working in web archiving since 2001, but the project formally began in 2007. And it is used worldwide. So about half of our users are international, not Portuguese. And all our user interfaces and documentation are available in Portuguese and in English to facilitate that anyone can use it. And even if you find the content that is written in Portuguese, these days you can use tools like Google Translate to translate the content and enable cross-lingual access to the preserved content. This is the oldest page that we have. It's from the 1993. It's from a Portuguese university. And on the right is the oldest image that we have. That is from 1992. So the one on the left is from Portuguese university, and the one on the right is from NADSA. It's quite interesting. So an example of a national and an international content that we have. So how anyone can search and access the preserved information? So you can search pages from the past in any language. So you can go to the archive.pt and try it in your own language. Obviously, we have most of our content is in Portuguese and also in English. But you can try it and tell us what you found. The interesting part, so you see here, it looks like a search engine, but the interesting part are the calendars. This is where everything changes. Well, I usually say that time changes everything. So when we restrict the time span of your search, you get different results. And this is quite interesting. And this is how a web archive search engine is different from a live web search engine. So if you know the address of a page, you can just type the URL and you get all the versions that we have archived. And you can just click on one of them. And this is our replay interface, and you can see the news of the BBC website 10 years ago. And on the left, you can just drill down along the multiple versions that we have, and you can also browse the page as they were back in the past. So you can just go back in time. You can also search images from the past. So here I look for Warsaw City, and you can also first, you get the images that we found related to the search query, but then you can click on the image and see where did the image appear. And this is very important to understand the context where the image appears. Okay, so you can also then visit also the web archive page. And all this information and all these services that I just briefly described can be accessed through application programming interfaces. So we are a research infrastructure. We know that we'll never be able to fulfill the requirements of all the users of all the research use cases. So we get information, preserve information, and provide access to information. And in this case, we provide application programming interfaces so that other people and other researchers can, on their turn, develop innovative applications. So we have two APIs that are specific to our service that basically enable the exploitation of all our functions. But then we also provide for interoperability the Memento API, which is international protocol, or the CDX server API, which is not international protocol but is widely supported by most web archives. So this way, our archive can interoperate with other web archives. Applications made for other web archives can be applied on ours, and this is a very, very useful way of developing things. So the best thing to see is one of these application that was developed. It's called Tell Me Stories. So this basically generates, automatically generates narratives about any subject based on online news from the past. This is really, really handy. It saves you a lot of time. So if you want to know something about someone or some event, you go to this application that we did not develop. It was made by researchers. One of them was here, Adam. So he was part of the team. They were the winners of the Archive.pt award in 2018. So this is just right. It's great. So about the collections and the automatic selection of content. So we decided to, we don't have a catalog, a pretty created catalog like libraries do. We don't have the resources to do that, and it's quite difficult to do it when you're dealing with so much information, but we decided to expose what we have. So at this address, archive.pt/collections, you will get a spreadsheet where we present some metadata about the collections that we have. Many of them are related to Portugal, but many others are of international interest. And we developed a low-cost methodology to automatically select and preserve online information about any topic. We have a paper on that, that we actually, the motivation for this was to preserve the websites of research and development projects. So we did this to preserve the web's attention that these are not, is not information that is preserved by the publications office, that is being done by the publications office. These are the URLs of the websites of the projects that typically disappear when the project ends. So we did this this research, and there are thousands of them, so it's really hard to find them by hand. So we developed this methodology, and you can find how, and then we expand it to find information about any other topics like collections. And that was actually what we did on the follow-up experiments to preserve European Union web content. So we, in collaborations also with the publications office, we did a cross-lingual collection about the 2019 European elections. So basically we thought that we would collect information about European elections regarding to Portugal, but then we thought, why can't we be a little bit more ambitious? And then we basically collected a set of keywords about the elections, then we translate them using automatic translation, then we ask help from the publications office of the European Union, and they helped us to correct all the translations correctly. Stuck this word. And then we submit this information through a web search API, and then we got the URLs, and then we collect the information. So in a nutshell, this is the methodology. And we have been preserving a research and development project funded by the EU since FP4, the ones that were still available. And now we're currently finishing the crawl that we did about H2020 projects. So now I'm going to present some tools that anyone can use to support web preservation. So anyone can suggest a website to be preserved, okay? So it's a public form. Just go to archive.pt/suggest, and you can submit any domain in any language. Just need to submit the homepage, and then we collect the remaining site. And this is a relatively simple function, but really nice, actually. This is what I think. So we do the best we can when you're trying to crawl the information from the web to try to collect it the best that we can. But sometimes you cannot do as good as you would like. So on the left, you can see a website where an image is missing. It was about the coronavirus, I think in 2015. And the page looks obviously incomplete. But then if you go to the top right and you click on functions and then select complete page, we automatically go to the live web and to other web archives, try to get the information that is missing on this page, and then you complete the page, and the user gets the result that is on the right side. So there you can see a much more complete page. What is really nice about this is that then we keep this information, and afterwards it is integrated in archive.pt. So anyone can be a web curator of our collection. So anytime that you find something that is missing, just try to complete the page, and maybe you'll have some very pleasant surprise. And this is a service that you created that is have been getting a big success, has been a great success within the public administration. So basically what happens is that today is really easy to create websites. So they keep on appearing new websites for projects, for services, for events, for whatever. And then these websites, after the event, they get kind of abandoned. That's the correct word. So we abandoned our websites, but the cyber criminals don't abandon them. So after a while, they get hacked, and they are used for very bad things. And we only know this when it's too late. And usually the decision is that you shut down the website and lose all information. And this is really bad because these are very useful websites. And what we did is we created one service that's called the kif.pt memorial. So we collect all the information from the website, and then we redirect the domain to archive.pt, and the original website can be shut down. So you can see this in practice. You can see here, I'm looking on Google for UMIC Knowledge Society Agency. That was a governmental agency that was shut down, that ended functions in 2012. So, but today you go to Google and you look for this, and you get the result. And then you click on the result, and you get this warning saying that this agency no longer exists, but the content of the website was preserved by archive.pt, and then you can browse it on archive.pt, and then on the right, you can just access information. And this is really, really nice to hear, for instance, from a colleague of mine that she was accessing this for her work, and she was collecting information about training materials, but she didn't know that it was archive.pt or the memorial, but this maintains the information accessible. Okay, and another tool that we support, this is really also really simple to install, is that on most websites, when you don't have a given content, a user goes to our website and you don't have the content, you just say, page not found. So basically, it's page not found, good luck. And this is not very pleasant to the user, but you can do more at a very low cost. So just on the 404 not page not found, just put one line of code. And if the page exists on archive.pt or any other web archive, you'll say, okay, sorry, this page cannot be found, but you can visit an earlier version of this page on a given date. You can customize the warning. You can do what you feel more adequate to your case. And then people can visit an earlier version on archive.pt or any other web archive. So how can we explore the past web? So we have an annual award that basically grants awards to people that do works using archive.pt. So since 2018, we already did 4 editions, so you can at least get to know 12 amazing and really useful works did over archive.pt or web archives. So just browse archive.pt/awards, and you get really inspiring work about what you can do with the web archive. Every year I get surprised, and this is something that's really good to promote web archives. And it has the support of the President of the Republic in Portugal, which is in the picture. So also web archives, you can create web design museums. Like, how else could you create web design museums without web archives? If you take a print screen, it's not web design. It's an image. It does not have interaction. It's not hypertextual. So this is a use case that is kind of obvious. And if you want to know more about how to explore the past web, you can attend training courses about web preservation and research. We have a training program. So at this time, it is composed by 4 modules. So the first one is directed to any internet user. So it's basically we present summarily how can anyone use archive.pt. The second one introduces how to publish information so that it can be preserved. So it's more targeted at web authors or web developers. The third one is about the APIs. So this is more for developers or researchers. And the fourth one, do-it-yourself web archiving. This is really, really interesting because the tools these days enable anyone to be a web archivist as long as people know how to do it. And we did this training, and we have now some volunteer web archivists that do web archiving as they feel like it. For instance, there was a municipality that was doing web archiving about what was happening during the COVID pandemic in their region. So they were very targeted and knew very well what to archive. And then they sent it to us. And this was really motivating work. So we also have videos in English, and most of our content is also available in English. We do these trainings in Portuguese or in English. Okay, so this is the forum about how to preserve the Polish web archive. So I'll try to present, in my opinion, which are the main challenges and some suggestions or recommendations to start a web archive. Okay, so these are the three main challenges that I'm aware of. The first one is to hire and maintain skilled human resources. This is the most challenging part of doing web archiving. First, because web archiving requires specialists, but it's not taught at any university course. So there are courses on web archiving, but it's not taught. It's not even mentioned. So please, let's get the professors at universities saying at least that there are web archives, okay, and there are web archivists. And this will be a very good start. And the second one is that web archiving is big data. And we must compete with internet giants like Google or Facebook to hire, and even harder, to maintain our resources. Because after we train them, most of the times we cannot keep them for long. The second part, or the second challenge, is the cost of dissemination. So after you do a very long journey of creating a good web archive, really useful, you get the frustration of people not knowing it. And you need a lot of resources to disseminate any web services. Again, once again, you're competing for the attention of people with the world giants, with the biggest companies in the world. And this is really hard because it's really hard to sell something for free these days because everything looks to be for free. And now the third challenge is the lack of awareness about the value of online information. So the information that basically rules our current world is published exclusively online. It does. It's not paper, it's online and it's digital. And if many decision makers or politicians or journalists say information is power, that is the new oil. Look into the past to see the future. Everybody says this every time and we cheer, and it's true. However, societies passively lose most of their online information. This does not look like, okay, data is the new oil, but you keep on losing data. Information is power, but you keep on losing information. And what information do you lose? Basically, all of it, because everything is online. So something is wrong here, and this is a lack of awareness. I only have to say two or three sentences to anyone to understand this, but people need to hear these sentences. But I'm going to help you a little bit. So I'm going to show, instead of sentences, I'm going to show you numbers. So let's measure the value of preserving online information or the waste of not doing it. So I'm going to present some gross estimation about the estimated on create the online information that is currently preserved in archive.pt, okay? So I went to Google and said that the average cost of a website to make the design and development is more or less 5,600 euros per website. So we have 27 million. So people in general, societies, companies, organizations spend 151,000 million euros in design and development. But when you're talking about content, here we add up 544,000 million euros. So we spent 695,000 million euros producing data that is online. It's a lot of money. How much is it? It's three times more than the gross domestic product of Portugal, that if Portugal was not preserving it, would be completely lost, as other countries, organizations are losing it. So the question that we ask ourselves, and you must ask our decision makers, can we afford to waste all this investment? Because this data may not be completely lost. We're just losing our own data, but someone else might be keeping it. And it is. And they are. Okay, so we should at least keep our own data, okay? We spend all this money producing it. So recommendations to start a web archive on a more positive note, okay? So no part-time web archivists. Okay, this is too demanding, it's too complex. You have to think about it from day to night, every day. It's really hard work, so it requires full dedication. And start with a small but autonomous web archiving team so that it does not have to permanently compete for the resources, okay? So if you have only resource to have one person, just put one person. Don't put five persons that someday at a given time will work in web archiving. This will not work. At least have one web archivist, okay? Use existing tools and services, like webrecorder.net has a lot of great ready-to-use tools, or the Archive.it cloud service, so it's really good. Third recommendation, listen to your users. Don't guess what they need. Hire user experience researchers. This is something that everybody that works in information systems like to do, is to develop systems that they guess that will fulfill the user requirements. Usually that usually doesn't work. And the fourth is start small, but perform the full workflow. So start by preserving a short list of websites, but perform the full preservation cycle. Collect, store, provide access, and disseminate the service. And this can be only your website or a few websites, but do the full workflow so that you can estimate the resources that you need. Okay, so I don't have time for more. I could talk a lot more. So please, if you like, read this book. That's why we wrote it. There's a preprint version available in open access, so it's not the final version, but you can get an idea about how you can explore web archives, especially if you don't have time or patience to read the whole book, because some parts are quite technical. Read the last part. It was written by Julien Massenet, that was the father of web archiving in Europe, and it's a look into the future. So if you want to know how to build a web archive, this is a very good start by reading this part at least. So, time's up. Keep in touch if you like. Send me an email or can subscribe to our mailing list in English or follow our news at our social networks. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Great. It's a shame that I didn't know about this project. My name is Maciej Piasecki. I'm representing Klawin Research Technology, Research Infrastructure for Language Technology. It's a European research infrastructure. I think that your project is an amazing source of data. And the only question is it possible to get access to the data for processing, not just browsing single pages and via browser interface, but for example having a possibility to get access to some 100,000 millions of web pages for processing from the point of view of some research questions.
Yeah, so basically the API was developed to fulfill that requirement, so you can get, with time and resources, you can get all the information you may need. But what happens is that most researchers, they don't want all the information. Is that what researchers say is not what they need? Or what do you think researchers may need? They want everything, but then we give them everything and it's too much. So most of the research use cases that we identified, people want a given set of URLs or a given set of websites. So it's much better to have the API or to provide the API than to provide the raw data. Nonetheless, we provide access to the raw data on a collaboration premise. So basically, if there's a researcher that wants to do some kind of study, we can do a collaboration protocol and you can provide them the access to raw data. But after the first meeting, most of the researchers say, well, second thought, I don't want access to the old data.
We are Klawin. We just work on between the users and the data, because we offer to our users for free, because Klawin is just research open research infrastructure. We offer different tools for processing text and speech in different languages. So we often get such research questions. Researchers coming to us with some research questions, and we advise them what kind of tools they can use. And the main problem is mostly to find the source of data that can serve research. I'll talk to you after. Sure. Thank you very much.
Oczywiście czas na rozmowy kuluarowe będzie jeszcze dzisiaj i od razu mamy pytanie naszego gościa z Węgier, czyli tak naprawdę mikrofon obok.
I just would like to take a comment to this, that there are some really interesting service cases, for example, in Denmark, where the researchers can specify research topics and research questions to the National Library, and they can discuss what kind of data set the National Library can provide to them. And even the copyright restrictions are very strict, but the law allows the researchers to take data sets. So also that Daniel said that not just this direct services, but and for all of us it will be even more important to serve the researchers' needs, and the collaboration is essential in this sense also. Thank you.
Thank you. Czyli rozumiem bardziej dopowiedzenie Martona, a nie pytanie. Czy jeszcze mamy jakieś pytania z sali? No to ja w takim razie mam do Daniela pytanie, a raczej trzy pytania w jednym pytaniu. Tak ekwilibrystyczny zabieg zastosował jeden z naszych widzów. A zatem, czy archiwo PT gromadzi zasoby pochodzące spoza domeny krajowej, portugalskiej oczywiście, .pt? Jeśli tak, to jakie i w jaki sposób?
Yes, we have very different collections. Just to give an example, the collections that we did on the projects of on the websites of the projects of the European Union research projects for different domains. So also when we collected the European elections, also the information was spread along different domains. So when someone suggests a website, it can be on different domains. So basically what we say is that the core is the .pt domain, but then we get information from several other domains. Every day we collect a set of online publications that are Portuguese, and some of them are not under the .pt domain. So basically think about the country code top-level domains just as a starting point, because a lot of very useful information will be outside of that domain. But on the other hand, if you also collect only the country code top-level domain, this can cause technical difficulties, because these days websites are just a mashup of code that comes from different parts. So most of the websites will not work. I won't go too much detail on this, but you cannot be very narrow scoped on the question of the country code top-level domain.
Dziękuję bardzo za tę odpowiedź. Czy jeszcze mają Państwo jakieś pytania? Nasi widzowie? A zatem pewnie... Marton? Potrzebujemy mikrofonu. To będzie pytanie, tym razem nie komentarz.
What kind of experiences do you have about these courses you mentioned? Who are applying for? How many people? Do you have some positive impact experiences in this thing?
Yes. Yes. It has been a great initiative to promote the service. And we are doing them also in person. And then with the pandemic, we had to change to a more online environment. And it worked really well. Like, we have start to reach much more people than we were doing with in person. I think that last year we have over 700 participants in total of all the training sessions that we did. And one thing that is working really well is that, well, we have our community that's close to us, so these ones already know us. So now we need to outreach. So what we do is that we establish a collaboration with a library or a governmental institution or a company or whoever wants to collaborate with us, and we do a joint training course. And then they bring their community. So we offer the training, they bring their community, and this helps us to expand our community, because, as I said, the costs of dissemination are overwhelming. You need to spend much more money on disseminating than you expend on keeping a service, which is already quite expensive. Well, no, it's not expensive. Like, for the value that I expect, I motivated you to believe in, I believe it's quite cheap. But the training courses is something that we must invest on, and especially on how to use web archives, because the IPC has been doing great work on training new web archivists, and it's really useful, but we need to get more users. So we need to get training on how to use web archives. First, they exist, this is how they use them, and this is really important. This is also one motivation that led us to write the book that I presented.
Daniel, a zatem jeszcze jedno pytanie od naszych widzów. Czy użytkownicy Archiwo.pt często zgłaszają strony do archiwizacji?
No, they do not. I mean, how often? We get like a few each week, but not a lot. But I think that is lots also a consequence of not being able to keep Archive.pt as a top of mind, because people, you need to have a very strong marketing so that people, when they see something interesting, they remember, oh, I'm going to suggest this to be preserved, because this is something that some person sees, really nice, but 1 year from now won't remember to do. So it's not keeping Archive.pt as a top of mind, but to keep every web archive on top of mind. And this requires permanent investment.
Bardzo dziękuję za odpowiedź na to pytanie. Jeszcze jedno pytanie i poprosimy o mikrofon. Poproszę o mikrofon.
I have a strong voice, so thank you. Are you not interested in other websites in Portuguese language? I mean Brazilian, Mozambique, Angolan. Are you interested in?
Yeah, sure. We did some efforts on preserving. We have quite a lot of websites from the Portuguese-speaking countries. And for Brazil, we cannot do an exhaustive crawl because it requires additional resources that we don't have. So we just collect a few websites from Brazil. From most of the African countries, we do, I won't say exhaustive, but we keep a lot of them. And some Portuguese, and for instance, in the case of Guinea, most of their domain was spammed. It was a surprise us to know that most of that content was not really that useful. Most of the content from Guinea people were outside of their own national domain. So this is tricky, this issue of the country called top-level domain. Sometimes they work really well, sometimes they work really bad. But yes, we've been working on that. And we tried to, and we have meetings with the Brazilian partners, and they're also interested, and they have started to work on that.
Mamy pytanie.
I wanted to ask, what is the process when it comes to signing up to your course? Can anyone sign up, or does it have to be an institution? And what is the cost of signing up?
Okay, the courses are for free. So when we were doing them in person, it just had to guarantee a minimal number of subscriptions. So it had to be at least 15 participants. And obviously, this depends. Like, if it's in the Lisbon area, don't charge for anything. And if the organization belongs to the Ministry of Science of Higher Education, we also don't charge, because it's just part of our mission. Now, imagine that it involves traveling and accommodation, and is very far. In this case, we have to agree on the splitting the expenses. But we don't charge anything for providing the training. And the model usually is this. Sometimes we do open training courses and we announce them, and people just subscribe. And this was a very interesting initiative that we had when the lockdown began. We started the Café with Arquivo, Coffee with Arquivo, PT. So we talked or asked people to talk in an informal Zoom meeting. And we just opened up to whomever want to join in. And this was really interesting. So this was kind of a training course. So people just came in and attended and participated. Obviously, there was a team for each session. So in a nutshell, we basically do collaborations with other organizations. We don't charge anything for the training course, but we charge for the involved expenses that may occur. We are now planning, if you can, next year to start working on a MOOC, a massive open online course. And this will, if this works well, it could be one way of expanding web archiving, because it's something that is not, after it is created, it does not involve our resources, because it's on a platform and people can just learn there by their own.